What an amazing turnout for tonight's Oppenheimer lecture. I'm really pleased to see everyone here. So the rules, if you heard, was that we can't sit in front of any of the doors, but you're welcome to stand. Just leave room for people to come through the aisles. There's a little bit more space up here to sit on the floor if you'd like. There's some room over here to sit. We can sit in front of these doors where Susan is waving over here. So I hope everybody can find a place to come in. So. Good evening, everyone. My name is Steve Boggs. I'm chair of the physics department, and it's my privilege to welcome everyone here to the J. Robert Oppenheimer lecture series. Many of you here today have attended previous Oppenheimer lectures, so you're aware of the motivation for this series and the history of our department tied to Oppenheimer. But for our new guests, I'd like to spend just a couple of moments outlining the history. After graduating from Harvard, Oppenheimer studied experimental physics for 1 year under J.J. Thomson before switching to theory. I think he was a little bored with experimental work. And he finished his PhD at the age of 22 under Max Born, the famous Born, and he was focusing on aspects of newly developed quantum theory, including the development of the famous Born-Oppenheimer approximation that's in many textbooks today. In 1929, the 25-year-old Oppenheimer joined the Berkeley Physics as an assistant professor, and during his 13 years at Berkeley, Oppenheimer made fundamental contributions to theoretical work in astrophysics, nuclear physics, spectroscopy, and quantum field theory. He wrote a number of very important papers, including several early papers that predicted the existence of what we today call black holes. Oppenheimer was a contemporary, colleague, and friend of Ernest Lawrence. Together, their theoretical work and experimental work, along with other prominent professors, transformed Berkeley physics into one of the premier physics departments in the world, a legacy that continues today. Oppenheimer is credited with being one of the founders of the American School of Theoretical Physics that rose to prominence in the 1930s. Oppenheimer loved quantum mechanics, quantum theory, and he referred to himself as a propagator of the theory. He enjoyed explaining, that's an inside joke. He enjoyed explaining the theory to his fellow faculty and students. And what he said was what this was about, where, what had been learned, and what the unsolved problems were. And that's his, that was his take on why he loved quantum theory and what he liked to explain. Today, 86 years from when Oppenheimer first came to our campus, his work and legacy continues to inspire theorists to address even more challenging unsolved problems. And this annual lecture in honor of Oppenheimer affords us the opportunity to hear from some of the most brilliant theorists in the world. Speakers that have been in this lecture series include Murray Gell-Mann, Kip Thorne, Stephen Hawking, Freeman Dyson, Chen-Ning Yang, Claude Cohen-Tanuji, Lisa Randall, Bruno Zimino, Ed Witten, Martin Rees, and our own Marv Cohen, among other notable theorists. So it's an amazing list of people who have joined us as Oppenheimer lecturers. In total, 6 Nobel laureates and many prominent theorists in the fields of particle physics, condensed matter, astrophysics, cosmology, and AMO physics. The Oppenheimer Lecture is one of 2 public talks we offer annually through the Berkeley Physics, and it started with an endowed gift from Robert and Jane Wilson more than 20 years ago. And since then, we have been fortunate to have received additional support from many individuals, including 2 who are here tonight. So please thank me in joining Steve and Arlene Krieger for their commitment to this distinguished lecture season. So Steve and Arlene, where are you? Where are you at? There they are, thank you. I'm blinded by the lights up here. So, okay, so where are we at? Okay, it's perhaps ironic that Oppenheimer himself was initially very challenged by lecturing at Berkeley. He worked over hard to come a stammer, to speak audibly, and to pace his presentation of material. He overcame these challenges in time and became known for lectures that inspired both theorists and experimentalists alike. Such inspiration is exactly what we look for when inviting the honored speakers for this series. And now let me introduce today's speaker, Professor Andrei Linde of Stanford University. He is joining us as our 18th Distinguished Oppenheimer Lecture. Born in Moscow, Andrei Linde studied physics at Moscow State University. In 1975, he joined the Lebedev Physical Institute, and he became a professor of physics in 1985. In 1989, he joined the theory division at CERN, and 1 year later, he joined Stanford University. Linde is one of the authors of the inflationary universe scenario, which is gradually becoming a standard paradigm of modern cosmology. He invented its most popular versions, such as new inflation and chaotic inflation. His theory of an internal chaotic inflation suggests that our universe is actually a multiverse consisting of many inflationary universes with different properties, each of which sprout from an internal cosmic tree. In 2003, together with collaborators Kotru, Kalosh, and Trivedi, he developed the mechanism of vacuum stabilization in string theory. It serves as a basis for many recent attempts to construct realistic models of elementary particle physics and the theory of an inflationary universe. He is the author of 280 papers and 2 books on particle physics and inflationary cosmology. He's been awarded numerous honors, including the Lomonosov Prize of the Academy of the Soviet Union for theory of the cosmological phase transitions. I had that perfectly just 10 minutes ago when I was practicing it. You can ask Professor Kolomensky. Okay, the Oscar Klein Medal in Physics, the Dirac Medal, the Gruber Cosmology Prize, the Robinson Prize for Cosmology, the Medal of the Institute of Astrophysics in Paris, the Fundamental Physics Prize, and 2014 he received the Kavli Prize in Astrophysics. He's also been elected a member of both the National Academy of Sciences and the American Academy of Arts and Sciences. His lecture today is entitled Universe or Multiverse. Please join me in welcoming Professor Andrei Linde.
Thanks. Thank you so much. Well, we came to this area together with my wife, Renata Kalish, approximately 25 years ago. I remember that first our friends Bruno Zumina and Marike Gayar invited us to their house somewhere uphill here. And it was night, and all of these airplanes sitting and the bay nearby and everything shining. And I said, my God, this is just a dream. So I'm in a state, well, for 25 years already. I'm very happy to be here and to visit our friends again and again in this place. Okay, so the subject today is universe or multiverse. And the reason why we consider these two words together, actually the concept of multiverse is pretty recent. It was all the time universe in a sense, it is still remains so, but there is something else which appeared in our lexicon recently, which require new words somehow to understand, to explain even what we mean by that. And it all substantially started with the invention of inflationary cosmology. But on the other hand, the way of asking these questions go back in some way to this long, long statement, which was for your viewing pleasure already for quite a while, and that belongs to Albert Einstein. He had written it in his autobiographical notes, which were supposed like his obituaries. He was writing it himself about himself and, okay, well, so that's what I think. Well, so what he said is that I would like to state a theorem which at present cannot be based upon anything more than a faith. That is interesting when the person says something which he is, well, deeply believe in, and on the other hand, he admits that there's a caveat here. So let's do it softly, okay? So it was a desire which actually in the heart of all of us to find some simplest explanation of all facts of our world. And simplest, but no simpler than the true. Okay, so then the question is, can we do something like, well, finding one explanation which will explain just everything, which will allow to predict everything, not only the predict to, well, what happened with the next president, but just everything else. Oh, you consider multiple choices. That is what the talk is about, right? This is about the multiverse. That's many possibilities, some of which are fundamental and some of which are environmental. Some things happen without any fundamental reason, and maybe that's why we see part of the universe which we live right now the way we are. But let's try nevertheless to pay attention to this idea that let's try to do our best in simplicity and maybe even in the possibility that there will be one unique theory which is the only one which is logically possible, and that would be great. So we were trying to do it, and one thing which we were trying to do as cosmologists is to address at least one part of this story. And that is when we look to the right of us and we look to the left of us, the mass of the electron is the same in that galaxy and in that galaxy. So somehow, distribution of galaxies over the sky is also uniform. So this is experimental fact. We want to understand why is it so, why the laws of physics do not change when we go from one place to another, why the properties of the universe do not change. That is uniformity of the universe. So we started trying to explain the origin of this, well, experimental fact that we observe right now. And the way to explain it was inflationary cosmology. And then when we start developing further and further and further, we did part of the job, and then suddenly we have seen that actually this is not exactly what we were planning to get, and that will be what I will be talking about today. So here is some situation, what we had about 30 years ago, a little bit more than that, when we had this Big Bang theory, which at that time was extremely popular. We knew that it must be true because it was explaining so many facts of our life. But there were some problems about it, which were kind of metaphysical. And one of these metaphysical problems, what was before the Big Bang? Because, well, when things banged, so what was before the bang? And when you open the textbook by Landau and Lipschitz and read it, and that was how we learned, general theory of relativity in Russia, there was a book where it was described. And the author said that the solutions of Einstein equations cannot be continued to negative time, to the place where, well, not zero when everything started, but before that. And because it's impossible to continue this equation, it does not make any sense to ask where the universe came from. On the other hand, sensible or nonsensible, but everybody continue asking. Then, why is our universe so uniform? Universe so uniform? So the answer to this question, or attempt to give the answer, was suggested by Albert Einstein, who said this is cosmological principle. The universe is uniform. Actually, Newton also used the same principle. At some time, I didn't know that this was a principle which these people used, so I used to make a joke that some people who don't have good ideas, they have principles. but then I understand that I should be probably shut up. And here is another question. Why the universe is not exactly uniform? Because you have galaxies. And galaxies are very important for our life, and they are non-uniformities. So you cannot just say that our universe must be uniform. Oh, sorry, galaxies, but don't pay attention. So this is then not really a matter of principle, like the person who takes small bribes. This is not a person of principle, right? Okay, so why the universe is isotropic? Isotropic means, well, everything that we feel for granted, that the universe in this and in that direction is approximately the same. So the universe looks like something spherical instead of being like a cucumber, okay? So why not? Now, this is a physical question. We know that the universe is isotropic. What I mean by that is not only all this abstract thing about cucumber or whatever, but like why don't the universe rotate? The universe may rotate, nothing forbids it to rotate. People measure it, whether it is rotating. They didn't find any rotation with a huge accuracy. Why doesn't every galaxy rotates? Our solar system consists of planets rotating about the sun. Our universe doesn't, okay? Why there is no axis in the universe? Well, this is not so certain. Maybe some of you have heard about axis of evil, and I'm not talking about countries, I'm talking about something in the sky. Anyway, so it is isotropic with enormous accuracy. So why is it so? Why all of its different parts start expanding at the same time? Because if the universe, well, was big, like the universe, okay? So this part did not know that it's time to start because it was time zero. So they could not exchange information that it is already time to start. So who gave the signal? Well, this is not the way physicists like this question to be posed, who gave the signal. So when I was reading it, when I was a student, I remember I had a flu and I was reading this, the journal explaining the theory of the Big Bang that all different parts of the universe start expanding simultaneously. I thought, oh my God, I guess I am really sick because I really do not understand what it is. How the universe could have started expansion simultaneously, who gave the signal? And I thought that maybe when I will grow older, I will go to my professors, ask the question, and they will explain me what is wrong about it. And then when I grow older, went to Moscow State University, and I learned that professors did not know that the question exists. Why the universe is flat? What do I mean is that in school, they tell us that parallel lines are parallel. They do not intersect. That's Euclid told us about that. Then we go to the university. They say that space is actually curved, and parallel lines can intersect or can diverge at infinity. There are two different possibilities that our universe is closed, and it has geometry similar to the surface of a globe. Parallel lines, which are parallel near the equator, they meet at the south and the north pole of the Earth, or the universe. So then why don't we see these parallel lines intersecting? So they could be parallel, but not for long. And apparently, it's a very difficult problem to solve. This being flat is characterized by some number. If the universe is closed, then this number is bigger than one. If it's open, then it's smaller than one. If it is exactly one, then it's flat. So people thought that maybe if we start with a universe with reasonably flattish, then we get eventually our very flat universe. But what later we have learned, that you must have started with a universe which is extraordinarily flat to get anything close to flatness right now. So there was a problem. And then there's another problem which is equivalent to this one, even though it at first glance seemed very different. Why there are so many people in this auditorium? And the answer to this, well, there are so many people in Berkeley, and some of them decided to come. Why are there so many people in Berkeley? There are so much more people on the Earth, and some of them live in US, and some of them live in Berkeley, and some of them decided to come. Why there are so many people on the Earth? Oh, you know what? We just discovered 1,000 different planets which are very similar to our Earth. We're actually learning that almost every star has a planetary system like ours. So in our galaxy, there are approximately 100 billion stars, okay? And some of the stars have planets, some of the planets have people, and some of the people live on the Earth, and some of the Earth, whatever, and they came to the lecture. And then the question is, why there are so many stars in the galaxy? Well, do you know how many galaxies in our part of the universe? 100 billion galaxies. And then everything repeats. And then the question is, what? Why the universe is so big to accumulate all of these galaxies, etc.? And the answer is like father tells his child, shut up. The universe is big because it's a universe. Okay. So this is what we knew about the universe. We did not really know why it is big. It was just big, okay? So what we learned that It is hard, and we still do not have any convincing answer to this first question, but the existing answer, mostly they are rotating about using some of the advantages which inflationary cosmology provides us with. And as for all of these other questions, answer to them have been provided by inflationary cosmology. So this happened, these first models of inflation, they have been invented more than 30 years ago. During 30 years ago, we changed our own opinion about it. At first, it was like a wild dream. At second, it was a dream. And third, it was a reality. And now it is certainty for some of us. Well. So this is what I'm going to tell you about, because yes, you tell about this, about certainty, somebody else, and somebody will start laughing. So let's try to explain. This is the simplest model which explains, not necessarily correct, but it is a good model explaining the nature of inflationary theory. So what we have here, we have something which is called scalar field. Sorry, we will need to use this concept, but for a while. It will be painless because nobody will be examined later. But the idea is the following. You have heard about this God particle which was found at LHC, right? Okay, this is Higgs particle. So there is a field excitation of which this Higgs particle is, and this is called Higgs field. And the Higgs field is the simplest example of the scalar field. So if it does not make your life easier, here you have 110 volt in a socket, okay? So if you have just 110 volt all over the auditorium, you will not be, well, shocked by that. It will be just another vacuum state, no current. You need to have zero. 110 and zero, you have current, okay? If you have 110 here and 220 in Europe, God forbid touching both hands these two different places of the world. So difference matters. But if you have something potential, electrostatic potential, all over United States, there will be no current, okay? Now, scalar field is something like that, except for it may have energy density sitting in it. So the larger scalar field have energy density. And also, it changes properties of every particle in your body. In particular, Higgs field is the reason why all particles which we are made of are not massless, and that's why we are sitting here, not flying as light with speed, okay? So Higgs field is, we think, have been discovered. The field which drives inflation, we do not know. There are some models which even allow inflation to be driven by the Higgs field. But at the moment, let's just study the simplest scalar field which has energy, potential energy proportional for simplicity to the square of the value of the scalar field. Once again, it is not a required knowledge, and you may hear it like a song which tries to convey you the main set of emotions which we have about it. So we have this scalar field which drives inflation, and if it has even the simplest potential, like a parabolic potential, like the potential of a pendulum, then this simple model explains why the universe may expand exponentially in the very beginning. Well, actually, this was not the first model of inflation. The first model of inflation, as we have heard about it, was suggested by Alan Guth long ago. And the idea was explained like that. So let me first tell you the emotional part of this idea. Okay, so suppose you have a box filled with candy. So you have one cubic meter filled with 1,000 candies. Okay, now the universe expands, the box grows. So when the size of the box grows 10 times, the volume grows 1,000 times, and you still have the 1,000 candies. So for one square meter, you have just one candy. And then the universe continues expanding, and less candies you see, right? Okay. So that was the problem with the Big Bang, because when the universe is expanding, density of matter becomes smaller and smaller and smaller, and the universe slows down, a Big Bang is not so big. Now, inflation tells you approximately this. Let's take the box and fill it with heavy nothing. Okay, so it's like a vacuum which nevertheless have some vacuum energy sitting in it. energy density. So per one cubic meter, you have some special property of the vacuum which has some energy in it. And this is not a fake idea, because people from here in particular have discovered it in 98 that vacuum energy in our own vacuum, in our own universe, vacuum energy density is not equal to zero. This was, I believe, one of the most important discoveries of the 20th century. So I am proud to be in the same, well, part of the Earth where this has happened. Okay, now, so we know that energy density of vacuum is not zero. Let's just consider it. Let's take what is the consequence for that. So you have one cubic meter filled with nothing. Okay, so you expand it 10 times. What is inside? Nothing. What changed? Nothing changed. It's the same nothing inside. So per cubic meter, nothing changed. But now we have 1,000 of these cubic meters. So the total amount of matter there have grown 1,000 times. Okay, once again. So you start, because this is a trick. You start with heavy nothing, you expand it, and the total amount of heavy nothing grows. And as a result, if you continue expanding, and at some moment this decays, and one cubic meter you produce 1,000 candies, then because the total number of cubic meter will be huge, and in each of it will be 1,000 candies, you can feed all babies in the universe. So that is the basic idea of inflationary theory. You start with something similar to vacuum, not exactly vacuum, but some similar, and then you do the job. So this idea, not about candies, but something similar, this was the basic of old inflationary model by Alan Guth. But then, of course, you may argue, but if you have really empty anything, what is actually expansion? Because if you do not have any candies there, you do not have any marks, it's just heavy nothing, then it expands and you do not even know whether it expands or not. Okay? So this was one of the reasons why original model of inflation did not actually work. And it was replaced by some other model and some other model. And eventually, models which are used today, they're based on something more sophisticated, like this scale of field story. So to explain the scale of field story, let's assume that in the beginning, in some parts of the universe, scale of field was sufficiently large. So what does it mean? And now this is just to scare you a little, but also to show you that when I was talking about this heavy nothing, you are not obliged to take my word for it, because it sounds like the man is drunk, okay? But these are equations, they are very simple. They have been checked by scientists who know what scale of field is, and they are actually pretty simple. This one is somewhat simplified Einstein equation describing the motion of the universe. This radius of the universe, dot, means the speed of expansion of the universe, divided by its size. This is called Hubble constant, and it is proportional to energy density of the universe, okay? So, then this other equation is equation for the scale of field itself. It tells you that if you start with scale of field, it'll start moving, and this equation tells you how it is moving. And this, by the way, is equation for harmonic oscillator. So harmonic oscillator, everybody who had some memory of your school education in physics know that this is acceleration, this is a force, and dot is just to show you this is acceleration, two dots. And one dot means this is velocity, okay? So without this term, it's just equation for oscillator like that. But if you add this one, it's like oscillator with friction. If friction is large, the body moves down very, very slowly, very, very slowly. For a long time, it remains at the same distance from equilibrium position. This is this friction term in the equation for the scale of field. And friction is large when Hubble constant is large. So when Hubble constant is large, friction is large, and scale of field practically does not move. The universe expands, and vacuum practically does not change. So it's empty space filled with scale field phi, it's expanding, and vacuum energy practically does not change. So this is a logic of inflation. If scale field is large, Hubble constant is large, friction is large, field moves down slowly. If it moves down slowly, Hubble constant is nearly constant. But Hubble constant, according to Einstein equation, is this. And this is the simplest equation of mathematical physics. You solve it, and you get exponential expansion of the universe. I am not, well, forcing you to check the solutions. They are really very, very simple. I am just pointing it out to you that the basic idea of inflationary universe is very primitive. I do not know why people did not come to this idea like 50 years ago, because all equations were known. There are some mysteries of the universe and of human nature which remain mysteries. But this is very simple indeed. Now, the gain of this idea, a newborn universe can be as small as 10 to the minus 33 centimeters, can be as light as 10 to the minus 5 grams, and then after that, you wait 10 to the minus whatever 35 seconds, and boom, you get all of your universe. In general, there are some ideas even how to create the universe from nothing at all, but I'm not going to discuss it right now here. It's for questions after the lecture. Okay, there are even a question, how can you actually create the universe now in a laboratory? Okay, it's also for the extra questions. So now, you start with this universe. This is smallest size which you can imagine, because the smaller size, you can not measure anything there. Your rulers will be bent. You'll forget everything that you measure. This is called Planckian length. Very small mass, and you wait this small time, and you get this. This is the universe, which has a size 10 to the degree, and this is a big number, okay, and really does not matter in which units. Okay, because it's bigger than anything you can imagine, and we live in some tiny, tiny fraction of it. And that is why we see the universe is so uniform. We start from the red, it's red all the way out, okay? You start from something curved, you stretch it, and the universe becomes uncurved. You have parallel lines here meeting here, but we cannot see so much, because the maximal distance, which we can see right now, is the age of the universe, 10 billion years, or 14 billion years, but who cares? Okay, 14 billion, 13.8. Well, multiplied by speed of light. That's maximum which we can see right now. Well, actually, it's not quite correct. There's some coefficient there, but anyway. So we cannot see all of this. We cannot see these parallel lines intersecting. That's why parallel lines do not intersect. That's why Euclid is right. So after all of this time, we have a very simple idea which finally explains this idea of these 2,000 years ago when the person told us that parallel lines cannot intersect. Now we know why, okay? Now, on the other hand, this scenario which solves many of the problems which I listed to you before, why the universe started at the same time simultaneously, because it started from this tiny spot, So, and then everything emerged and all conditions were everywhere the same. So we can solve all of these problems, which I mentioned on one of the first pages. But then the question is, we may overdo it, because if the universe stretches so much, then your Himalaya is stretched into flat area and there will be no alpinism, whatever, because everything will be absolutely flat with this expansion. So we need to get galaxies. Well, happily, during the time when this theory was invented, it was also found that quantum fluctuations during inflation, quantum fluctuations which exist everywhere in this room as well, during this very rapid stage of expansion, they were stretched to enormous distance. And while they were stretching, they were frozen because of this friction term, which I've shown you, 3H5 dot, never mind. So they were frozen, and then new fluctuations were produced on the top of the previous ones. So previous were frozen, new were produced. Previous were frozen, new were produced. What is this mechanism? You take something quantum, and you get something classical. And just before coming here, I had discussion with some people here about this invention of laser. So what laser does? Laser takes something quantum and produces classical beam of light, coherent, containing many, many particles pointing in one particular direction. What our universe does. It takes these quantum fluctuations and stretches them. And from the quantum, it produces something big and classical, which is going to be our galaxies. Our galaxy is produced like that. But the difference is this laser produces the green beam. Okay? So it's just green beam and green beam and green. Actually, this laser maybe have some red heart in it, but there's something converting into green, but never mind. It is green now. What universe does? It produces these quantum fluctuations, it expands them, stretches them, and then redshift them. And if they produce it blue, they become red. And then they produce another blue, and they become red. And the ones which become red, they become infrared, and then very, very long wave. And then you produce all wavelengths. And as a result, you produce all collection of all these galaxies and everything which we see right now in the universe. That is the best and the only theory of producing seeds for emergence of galaxies which is presently available. It's science fiction. You create everything from 10 to the minus 5 grams of matter, and then you produce galaxies from quantum fluctuations. You must be totally insane to do this. Okay, but then how is that? You have 10 to the minus 5 grams of matter. We know that energy is conserved. So you cannot produce from 10 to the minus 5 grams of matter. You cannot produce everything. I must be cheating somewhere. Well, the answer to this question is actually quite paradoxical. Well, that's like that. The total energy of the universe actually is exactly zero. You have energy of matter and negative energy of gravity. And positive energy of matter during inflation start exponentially growing. Negative energy of gravity start exponentially growing, but it's negative. The sum of them is as small as it was originally. It is conserved, but it is just split. So inflation is exponential instability of our space with respect to the division into matter and the energy of gravity. And that is the trick. So it sounds very strange and philosophical, but forget about philosophy. Here are your equations. So it is possible to check it and do philosophy later. So that's why I decided to check, to show you this equation, to show that you would not trust me if I tell you that we are violating energy conservation here. But then here are equations, okay? So to check all of this, we launch satellites. One of these satellites, and people here also know these heroic developments many, many years ago. Some part of it was here, mostly in Berkeley. So this was COBE satellite, which was measured the first imprints of these quantum fluctuations on the sky. Then it was WMAP satellite, which continued this tradition. And they found this with much greater accuracy. And then later it was Planck satellite, and we're still getting new and new information. Planck satellite already stopped producing new results, but we are learning what they told us about our universe. So what they produce looks like that. So these are tiny, tiny spots, distribution of temperature on the whole sky. So we take all the sky that we can see, the most distant parts of it, okay? And we measure temperature of radiation which goes to us from different parts of it. It is an echo of the Big Bang. The universe was hot at some stage. Then when it was expanding, it cooled down. It has the same temperature in all possible directions. It is 2.7 Kelvin. But if we measure it carefully, we will see that actually it's like 1/1000th of a Kelvin more hot in this direction and 1,000 colder in this direction. And that's because our Earth moves with respect to the universe. And therefore, in the direction in which we move, we regard photons hitting us like more energetic. So these parts seem to be a little bit more hot. So we can subtract it from our results. And then everything becomes uniform again until we increase accuracy of measurement to approximately 10 to the minus 5 Kelvin. That's just incredible. That is the moment when even theorists like I start to respect my experimentalist colleagues. So this Planck satellite people produced this image, and they were trying to, explain general public that this is what we get, And these are our magnificent results. And then the public asked them, so how much your experiment cost? And they would say, oh, approximately $1 billion. $1 billion for that? I will just go to Home Depot and I will spray you everything much cheaper, because this doesn't seem to contain any interesting information about it. So, and actually, this is not a joke. These people would come to me and say, what can we do? Because we cannot excite anybody by this picture. I say, just tell them that what you see, each of these spots, you are seeing right now quantum fluctuations produced at the 10 to the minus 35 seconds, like a billions of a billions of a billions of a second, more than that, after the moment of creation of the world. And then it is stretched on the largest size available, the largest photographic plate which is ever being possible. And then you are watching it right now. These quantum fluctuations, they are responsible for galaxies, for creation of the structure of the universe. This is more magnificent than any other painting which you can buy for whatever money you can want to spend everywhere on the earth. Okay, and then one of them told, yes, I made this mistake. One person belonging to Planck, I made this mistake. And I told once at the press conference that some of my colleagues would sell their children to see this picture, and they still cannot forgive me that. Okay, so now the latest Planck data. And this looks, oh yeah, well, you need to have it with a really good resolution. So what you see here, it's like, oh my God, I cannot even describe it to you. So you need to have it at a much better focus. You will see some like fluxes moving here. They are not fluxes. This is polarization of these perturbations of CMB. So you have this incredible accuracy to see the small spots. Now you see also that light coming here is slightly polarized. This is called E modes, okay? This is already incredible, advance. And then people are trying to find something else, which is called B mode, more about this later. On the basis of this, Planck produces, see these blue spots here? Okay, these are experimental results of Planck, which tells you how these spots are distributed. How many large spots, how many small spots on the sky. And this red line is prediction of simplest versions of inflationary cosmology. Okay, here there's something indefinite because these correspond to very large scales on the universe where we see the result of the universe of experiment which happens only once. So not good statistics. But at small scales, when you can have many measurements, you see the agreement is enormous. And then there's something else. There is a correlation for polarization. So this is not correlation between temperature fluctuation. I mean, that's just, well, incredible what these people are doing. And this is the way how they use the results. So this is the flatness of the universe. Inflationary universe predict that the universe, according to Euclid, but now according to the theory, must be very flat. So omega should be one. This will be flat universe. And now, well, in 95, 94, 96, people believe that omega is equal to 0.3. Okay, and they were telling, well, because your theory predicts omega equal one, your theory is ruled out. And we were trying to suggest some theories which nevertheless were inflationary and whatever. Okay, so we have 0.3, let's explain 0.3. We failed. And after that, many years later, in 98, we found that actually omega is close to one. That was the supernova data. And now, on the basis of recent Planck data, it's just one plus minus, and here is accuracy of 0.5% with, well, whatever. It's amazing. Now, these perturbations of temperature, they have some spectrum which is characterized by their measure of flatness. If it does not depend on the logarithm of scale, it's called flat, but inflationary theory typically predicted something, some deviation from flatness, and that is what we see right now experimentally. So this is also confirmed. Then there are some other features of this. I probably should not take your time because I also take my own time and then I will never come to the multiverse. I'm just telling you that what is going on, I'm just so lucky. And many of us are so lucky because these experiments are possible. And to see things which you predicted and other my friends predicted, you see them all in the sky. It's just incredible. You never believe that it's possible. But can you test inflation even better? Well, yet another Planck data release in about a year. So they did not release all of their data because they got the data. But it is very difficult to make sense out of it because there are so much of it, so many of them. It's necessary to do all correlations, and also it's all with Europe. Many countries, many institutions, and they all must agree. You know how difficult it is. Yeah, but they're doing a great job. And then another thing, and this another thing, will put some of us to, well, short living fame, certainly. They found that there are these additional perturbations on the sky, additional perturbations, which actually the experiment was magnificent. What they did, they found not only these perturbations of temperature and E-mode, but some other more subtle perturbations, which was extremely difficult to find. People spend years sitting at the South Pole. This is freezing there, okay? And also it was at night, which lasts there for half a year, which is why they go there perversely enough. They go there because the night lasts there a long time and nothing disturbs the perturbations, or the, well, observations. So they, what they found was a real thing. What they said that it means that we also find some gravitational waves coming to us from inflation. These, there is a good chance that it was not real or not the full thing of most of it was real. There will be some other sources of the signal which they have found are very plausible, and well, the simplest one is just scattering of light on dust. So some people here have shown that this is possible. Some people in other places shown this is possible. And I will demonstrate you right now the latest conclusions about it. But one way or another, there are right now lots of experiments trying to repeat, to improve these experiments they're finding, trying to find in a more detailed way this information. So this process is unstoppable. This is one of the results combined, this just Planck data. Planck data, this one shows you something which is called tilt of the spectrum. This is 0.96. This is the amplitude of these gravitational waves, if they're there. And these are results. And these results, previously they were all over the space. And then with every year, the possibilities are shrinking, shrinking, shrinking. And there are small island of possibilities is, well, showing up here. And then if you add there additional data, taking into account these gravitational wave experiments, then compare it. This was before you take into account bicep and Keck results, and this is after. So the data have shrunk even more. So the precision of the full set of conclusions with the help of these experiments actually becoming better. And that was something which was actually predicted here a year before the Planck delivered their results together with Bicep and Keck all together, that the constraints on the parameters, they become better and better. There are some theories which, like this my lovely theory, this quadratic potential, which is so simple. But now the prediction of the theory is somewhere here, and the best contours are here, so it is almost excluded, not entirely, but most probably excluded by experimental data. But there are some set of models, inflationary models, which predict exactly what they have found. And I will be unable to talk about many of them. I will just mention one. And this one is called alpha attractors, whatever. And I mention it because that's what we invented during last 2 years, Renata Kalish and I and some of our collaborators. This is what we had before. So it is parabolic potential. And this set of models has potentials which are parabolic here, but more complicated here. And what is interesting about this set of models is that they can be obtained in some very advanced class of theories called theories of supergravity, superconformal theories, conformally invariant models. And they produce a set of models which predict the same, approximately the same results for the satellite measurements, independently of whether I will start bending this potential at all. So that's pretty interesting story. So these predictions of this set of models, they're shown here by a straight line. It begins on at my m squared phi squared model, and it goes all the way down to this place. And this place here corresponds to something which is called Starobinsky model, which was invented by Alexei Starobinsky even before inflationary theory was invented. All this was the first inflationary model invented. I would not go to the debate about that, but the fact is that this is amazing that this model is here at the center of attention. And guess what? Our set of models for parameter alpha approximately equal one just exactly coincide with what is here. So we have a set of models which fit all experimental data pretty well. So now we're coming to the universe and multiverse eventually, okay? So what we're learning that uniformity of our universe is explained by inflation. That's the best way to do it. There are some other alternatives to explain the same properties of our space. Well, if you want, you ask me about them later. But my short opinion is that if there would be any working alternative for what we have right now, I would be first to run and to work on it. And I'm not. Now, the same theory, however, predicts that at a much larger scale, the universe is 100% non-uniform, and that is strange. We started trying to say, oh, Einstein wanted it, let it give it to him, okay? And now we found why the universe is so uniform. And the next step was because of some effects which I'm going to describe, the universe at a large scale with a very large probability becomes a multiverse. So first, the simple picture. So previously we start with a red sphere, okay? And then it blown up and it became a huge red sphere. Now I start with something which is, well, football, but just let's color it differently. So it's white, black, whatever. And then you have inflation and here is what you have. Person who lives here, he will look around and he will see surrounded by itself by the blue universe, okay? So he will never see this part because it's exponentially far away. And he will try to construct a theory which predicts, explains why the universe can be only blue, okay? The guy living here will try to construct a theory which explains why the universe must be red, and while everywhere in the universe, eventually it will be redness. Even if something is not red, it will be. Okay, people who live here in white universe will see only white. And here we have a better principle, which I call cosmopolitan principle. Somebody can live in red, somebody can live in blue, somebody can live in white. Our universe can be a multiverse, okay? And everything will be consistent with our observational data. Mass of electron here and here will be the same. They were produced from this blue space and it was stretched like that, okay? So then pessimist will say, if each part of the multiverse is huge, we'll never see other parts, so it's impossible to prove that we live in the multiverse. Optimist, well, optimist will say, if each part of the universe is huge, we'll never see other parts, so it's impossible to disprove that we live in the multiverse. And Einstein would say this, actually, this is what he said. I would rather be an optimist and a fool than a pessimist and right. Okay, wise man, so. This scenario, the reason why it is better to be optimist is because this scenario is more general than the scenario of the universe. See, all of us have different type of clothes, different colors, different texture and everything. It is all based on electrodynamics and a little bit of nuclear physics and whatever. So the laws are very, very simple, but the colors are all different. Now just imagine that you live in a country where they're all in gray, okay? And they say you must wear gray because gray is the only color possible. And I said, no, I want to live in a country where you can have blue and red and whatever. Okay, so that is why this is one reason. One reason that unless something is forbidden, it is allowed. Yeah, this is a principle. Well, sorry, it's maybe I should not make this joke, but this is a neutral joke, okay? So some of my old friends, while we were still living in Russia, he told me, what is the reason between Russia and US from the point of view of laws? Well, in Russia, everything which is not explicitly allowed is forbidden. In US, everything which is not explicitly forbidden is allowed, okay? So we want to have everything which is not explicitly forbidden to be allowed. Moreover, even if one starts with the same universe of the same color, quantum fluctuations during expansion of the universe make it multicolored. And that is example which I was working, more than 30 years ago. This is something which is called supersymmetric SU5 model, and it has one minimum, which is have one breaking of symmetry, another breaking, same scale of field, but it may fall into one of these three minima. And then the universe expands, it becomes exponentially large, but during expansion, even if you start in this minimum, this scale of field, quantum fluctuation is in it, push it in from one minimum to another. And then the universe becomes divided into pieces. And in some of the pieces, universe is green, and this is the laws of physics which allow us to exist. And in some pieces, some parts of the universe which are exponentially large, they're like exponentially large countries. You can call them universes because they're so large, but in fact, it's just exponentially large parts of our universe, no metaphysics, no universes flying around us. No, it's just exponential large countries. So in some of them, we cannot live because there are no electrons and protons, whatever, the quarks are the same as leptons. Our life of our type is impossible, but here we can live. And we even run computer simulations, which I call Kandinsky universe in the name of famous abstract painter. So here we may be not able to live, here we cannot live, and here we cannot live. So this is the universe which multicolors itself all the time due to quantum fluctuations. Alan Guth famously said, and that's very often cited statement, it is said that there is no such thing as a free lunch, but the universe is an ultimate free lunch because you produce, at that time he thought that we need lots of pounds of matter to produce the universe, and they just reduce it by, several billion times, okay? But, so it is really very free lunch. But then I made the following statement, and I made it at the conference in Cambridge, which was the first conference on inflationary cosmology in 82, and I was so impressed by free lunches provided there that I say that it is internal feast where all possible type of lunches, of dishes are served. So what does it bring to you? It tells you that our universe may consist of very different parts. Like on Earth, dolphins live in water. We live on dry land. Thank God we have two possibilities. That's why we have so many different species. And it is not such a challenge that we cannot live in water because we cannot live there. We also cannot live in an interstellar space. So there is nothing metaphysical in saying that the properties of our part of the universe are correlated with our properties, okay? If we know who we are, we know in which part of the universe we may live. It is not metaphysics, it's not religion, it's just a statement of fact, as long as you have these options. So previously, we did not have many of these options. Previously, in this SU5 theory, we have a dozen of different minima. But how we get many minima to really use this entropic principle and multiverse in a very broad sense? And it was, going up to the discovery, going down to the discovery by vacuum energy, which was extraordinarily small, and then Busse and Paczynski, Raphael sitting here, said that if we have many different vacuum, and it seems that we really have many, in string theory, then maybe if our universe consists of different parts with different properties of vacuum state, maybe we know why this vacuum energy which we have found, why it is so miserably small. Because if it is large, then we cannot live there. If it is negative and small, we cannot live there. And if we have many, many possibilities in one of them, we can live. Actually, I remember that in 84, when I was visiting Sakharov in his exile in Gorky, he suggested that if we have a universe made out of high dimensional Kaluza-Klein, whatever, space, well, multidimensional Kaluza-Klein compactifications, and the compactifications of extra dimensions may go in many different ways, and then we have many different possibilities for having vacuum energy. And he proposed this idea at that time already, that if we have many possibilities, we can explain why vacuum energy is so small. But string theory allowed to do it. Then in the year 2003, we found that actually it's not only an idea which might work, but it may work. Because there is some construction which, well, more or less convincingly or convincingly for some, or at least the proof of a possibility that we can have many vacuum states. And then some, Michael Douglas have estimated it, and in quite in a good agreement with what was expected before, he came with a number which is absolutely huge, maybe 10 to the degree 500 different vacuum states possible in string theory. And some of the main players which continue while working in this field are working here, like Raphael Busse, Lawrence Hall, Yasunori Nomura, many of their collaborators. So we live in the part of the multiverse where investigation of the multiverse, at least temporarily, is popular. Okay, this is a picture which helps to explain it, but you need really to have good imagination, understanding what it is shown here, and a better projector to show what it is, because it is kind of very special slice of so-called Calabi-Yau space, which is an illustration of how this compactification happens in string theory. And that is eventually the answer. So we have many different options. Now, if you have many options in different vacua, well, inflation makes the universe big. So then, in one part of it, one of these vacua is realized. In another part, the universe is colored differently, have different vacuum energy. And if vacuum energy is large, you cannot live there. If energy is negative, we cannot live there. And we can live here, and that's exactly what we see. So this is the only explanation of very small vacuum energy which we see right now. Is it a convincing explanation? If it is totally convincing for all of us, well, it is, I would say, it is the best, okay? It is the best available. We are trying to work out on the best and the best and better way to to make this theory as developed as possible. We are not yet there. But at the moment, it is the only explanation of this magic part, fact of our universe which we observed. That is just returning to Robert Oppenheimer. One of his sentences, the optimist, which we are, thinks that this is the best of all possible worlds, but the pessimist fears that this is true. Okay? So yeah, it is too early to make any definite conclusions, but I think that we have learned quite a lot about it. Can we test the multiverse theory? Many people say, if the multiverse consists of these different islands, and within each island, I can see only this island. Can I actually test that the whole theory is not like a fairy tale? Okay. So there are many different arguments about that. First of all, when we are testing inflation, we're already testing something which allows multiverse theory to exist in a consistent way. And there are many different tests of inflation. And it's very, very difficult to make inflation a theory which does not lead to the multiverse. So each time when we're testing inflation, we're closer and closer to confirming the idea of the multiverse. But there is something else. This theory provides the only known explanation of many known experimental data. What do I mean by that? Well, you have proton and neutron. Mass of a proton, mass of a neutron, they are almost equal to each other with accuracy better than 1%. If proton is like 1% heavier, then proton will be unstable. All hydrogen atoms and everything else will decay, and what you will have only neutron matter, okay, neutron stars. Physically, quite consistent theory. The only bad thing about it that we will not be around. If neutron will be a little bit heavier, then all heavy nuclei will decay, and what you'll have, you'll have protons. You have lots of hydrogen in the universe. No speaking people to talk about, but otherwise it will be pretty consistent physical theory. So the only property is that we will not be there, okay? So how then you can explain that proton and neutron so aligned? Oh, maybe there's some symmetry there. So many people try to do no symmetry, explain that. So why? Oh, because we are here. So now God created the universe with this proton specifically for this type of monkey to exist. So now what we have, the universe produces itself in all of its possible versions. And we live in the places where we can live and somebody else can live in some other places. We have 10 to the degree 500 choices, free world. Okay, you do not like it here, you just go to another. Well, so now another example, mass of the electron. Mass of the electron is 2,000 times almost lighter than the mass of the proton. So why it is so ugly? You have this theory of elementary particles. It is not enjoyable symmetry between masses of all particles. And mass of the neutrinos, and they're way below. Okay, so why somebody created the universe which would be so ugly from the point of view of properties of elementary particles? But if the mass of the electron would be 10 times smaller and 10 times larger, we would not be around. So again, we have a correlation between us and experimental data describing our universe. We measured this mass of the electron long ago. And so far, for 100 years, well, more than that, we know this mass of the electron. We do not have any other explanation of why is it so. Why our universe is three-dimensional plus one time, okay? Especially if string theory comes and say that our universe can be 10-dimensional. So why? String theory likes to live in 10 dimensions, okay? It's a problem to make it three dimensional. So why three dimensions? The answer to this question was given by Ehrenfest, Paul Ehrenfest, in the year 1917. He said that if our dimensions were not three, but four or five, then planetary systems would be unstable and atomic systems would be unstable. If our universe would be two-dimensional, one-dimensional, this is a less trivial thing. In general theory of relativity, there would be zero gravity forces between planets, okay? So only three-dimensional space would allow us to exist. So now we know why our universe is three-dimensional. This is experimental fact that our universe is three-dimensional. We have one explanation that is three-dimensional. And the only explanation is that we had something to choose, okay? So otherwise, you need to get it like a miracle. So this is a miracle. Our universe is just so fine-tuned for our own existence. So many miracles and one explanation. So we have one explanation, and the famous British philosopher formulated like that. When you have eliminated the impossible, whatever remains, however improbable, must be the truth, okay? And I agree with him almost completely, almost. Because I do not say that it's however improbable. What we suggest, I believe, is very, very probable. So multiverse, it just, well, logical consequence. Just a we did not want to invent it. It just so happened. We wanted to explain uniformity, but it just so happened that we predicted that the universe is more rich. And now, in order to go back and return to old concept of a single universe, we must first, propose alternative to inflationary theory and to string theory, because these theories predict the multiverse. Then we should also explain why only one vacuum of string theory, and not any other, is realistic. What forbids the freedom, okay? So you need really, oh my God, you must really, yeah, you must explain why you must wear a gray suit, okay? So all of them, when we have this demonstrated freedom, And then one should find an alternative solution of the cosmological constant problem and of many other coincidences which are solved or found only by the invention of inflationary theory. So if anybody has any suggestions, you are welcome to come and share them with me. This is an official end of the story, and now what I will say may be considered like a joke, but maybe not. So I will take like 3 more minutes to tell you something about what Einstein said. He said that the most incomprehensible thing about the universe is that it's comprehensible. Actually, I never knew the quote. I was watching TV, so sometimes you see something interesting on TV, and some well-educated woman physicist was giving interview on this Bloomberg TV, you know, this gray-haired wise person. What is his name? I don't remember. Yes, okay, good. So he was well prepared to that, and she was excellent in explaining him everything about these many worlds and, well, how you can slice the universe in different, and how you can live in five-dimensional universe. Somebody can live here, somebody can, and he said, yes. And the Einstein said that the most incomprehensible thing about the universe is that it's comprehensible. And she didn't know what to say with all of these theories. If she doesn't even know why her theories make any sense, because there is a miracle after all, how you can predict anything, yes, okay. And this is a full victory, okay? So that is, and I thought, my God, she does not know that the problem is already solved. We know why the universe is comprehensible. But then I learned that that Einstein was not the only one who asked the question. Eugen Wigner asked the following, said the following: the unreasonable efficiency of mathematics and science is a gift we neither understand nor deserve. That is such an example of self-humiliation, okay? We use mathematics, we do not know why we're so lucky that it makes any sense to use mathematics. And I thought, oh my God, there's something wrong is going on. Let me see what the present day mathematicians are writing about it. So this was Israel Gelfand, one Russian mathematician who was later living in New York, died recently. He said, there is only one thing which is more unreasonable than unreasonable effectiveness of mathematics and physics, and this is the unreasonable ineffectiveness of mathematics and biology. So I saw that if all of these people are playing the same game, maybe I should, well, voice my opinion about that. And the opinion is that the reason why Einstein was puzzled by efficiency of physics and Wigner was puzzled by efficiency of mathematics is very simple. The universe, they thought, is given to them in one copy. And therefore, somebody gave them this gift, unexplained and undeserved, that you live in the place where you are a physicist. Okay, here is your toys, and you play your toys and enjoy your life. You like physics, you play your physics toys. You are a mathematician, you play mathematician toys, and it's just so, huh, this is a gift which we didn't deserve, whatever, okay? So here is, in the inflationary multiverse, this problem, I would argue, and let be not so very much critical as some of us may be, okay? In the inflationary multiverse, the problem disappears. First of all, let's see what happens there. In the inflationary multiverse, there are some parts where the universe right now is still at the Planckian density. At the Planckian density, quantum fluctuations are so strong that whatever you write and measure and remember will be instantly erased, and there will be no mathematics there, okay? Because whatever you remember, you cannot use. So the laws of physics are necessary for us. The laws of mathematics are necessary for us to make calculations which allow us to win the game of evolution. In this part of the universe where the laws are changing every millisecond, we cannot live. So we do not live in the places of the universe where the laws of mathematics are unusable. Now there are some parts of the universe where there is nothing at all. You have just vacuum state, De Sitter vacuum state, only Boltzmann brains can live there. We cannot live there. Okay, and where the Boltzmann brains can remember anything, well, next time you meet them, you will ask. But what I'm saying is that we can live only in the parts of the universe where the laws of mathematics and physics allow stable information processing. After all, we're in a Silicon Valley, right? Information processing, which is necessary for our life here at this age, okay? And that's why physics and mathematics are so efficient in our part of the multiverse. We can at least approach the problems. We don't know whether this is an answer, but what we have is a context in which these kind of answers become not religious questions about God giving you the wisdom or laws of physics and mathematics, but maybe it is a way for you to think about it and maybe come to something, well, at least you may think about it seriously. This is an image of the universe which consists of many exponentially large parts, and only in some parts of the universe, people like Einstein can exist. And then he asked a question, why am I so lucky to live in the part of the universe which is so uniform and which I can understand? So now maybe we know why. Thanks a lot.
Is this on? Great. That was incredibly informative. Thank you, Professor Linde. So we are going to start taking questions. So we have, here we go.
Well, I was wanting to go back to Karl Popper and the original Einstein quote, which Einstein was thinking of coming up with constants exactly determined by pure mathematics. These are measured to sometimes 8 decimal places. And the anthropic principle just can't deliver that type of precision. So you end up with the argument against numerological things. It's just unscientific because you can't really prove anything. So what do you say about that?
Well, I would say, first of all, that when somebody tells me that something is unscientific, I well remember how different branches of sciences were forbidden in Russia where I came from. And I really would prefer not to have a statement that something which we are doing and considering science is considered by somebody unscientific. People may have their own opinion, but we are trying to do our best. Now, why we consider it scientific? Okay, that's a different issue. And the reason why we consider it scientific is that look at this example which I just told you about, this the argument which used by Sherlock Holmes. There are two different ways of finding reliable information, and only one was this principle of falsification. Everything that is falsifiable is science. Everything which cannot be falsified is not science. So this guy has its own idea. Let me give you the law, and if you don't obey my law, I will, well, punish you because this is my definition of truth and your definition does not matter. So here is what we do in practice. In practice, if a person killed his wife, then we come to the court with this person and we ask these 12 people to make a judgment based on the best evidence. And if they find that he is guilty beyond reasonable doubt, but how they find? One way is to repeat the experiment, to give him another wife and another knife and to do it. This would be scientific. Well, so that's what I'm saying, that the judgment sometimes does not go this way.
A kind of a fundamental, a dumb question. Long ago, I was told that no matter could move faster than the speed of light. And yet, in the Big Bang Theory, it appears that things were moving much faster than the speed of light in the first very small fractions of a second. What is the explanation for, is that because of things starting with vacuum and therefore without matter?
So, because what we are doing is based on the theory of relativity suggested by Einstein, whatever we are doing, if we are not making mistakes, cannot contradict the, well, the theory. I mean, if we are not making mistakes. But the serious answer is the following. You have two different concepts. One concept is the speed of a signal. So you send a wave, and this wave locally moves with certain velocity. This local velocity, sending a signal, cannot exceed the speed of light. Another possibility, you have a universe like a balloon, like a manifold, okay? You measure the distance between this galaxy and this galaxy. They are not talking with each other. They are just staying on this balloon, and the balloon is growing. There is no signal sent, but this galaxy moves away from that galaxy with whatever speed. Einstein theory doesn't impose any speed limitation for just expansion of the space as a whole. So there is no contradiction, it's just different concepts. There is speed of signal, that is what has bound on it.
There's a question in the middle of the room over here to the, yeah, hi. So, the question is about whether the laws of physics are extrinsic or intrinsic to particles. I'm naive about this stuff, so it's just thinking about what would happen if you were a person or a particle on the boundary between a blue and a yellow part of the universe, and you cross from one part to the other. Do your physics travel with you, or do you get the external laws of the other universe imposed upon you? Or does that even make any sense?
Yeah, that is, if you can be self-protected very well, then maybe your physics can travel with you, but most probably it wouldn't. Usually what happens, first of all, the law of physics, and now I am praying the God of unique law, okay? The law of physics, like you have one string theory, or like you have water, so you have liquid water, vapor, and ice, okay? So this is the same chemistry, absolutely different environment. Fish cannot live in ice. Fish live in liquid water. So for her, it's like different chemistry, different world. We have the same fundamental law of physics, but the universe is divided into different pieces where this law is realized differently. So it's the same law of physics, but realization is different. Like for the person who was, well, traveling on Titanic, he was sure that only one law of physics, of chemistry on the whole ocean, and that's why Titanic eventually sunk. This is the question. The question is when you approach to a different place where the different laws of low energy physics are valid, can you just go there and continue being alive there? It depends. It depends because when we're talking about this, there is a possibility of really, well, rigid and abrupt change of the law surrounding you. Or you may have something smoothly changes, and both type of changes are possible. For example, there is something which is called axion field. Okay, axion field may play the role of dark matter in this universe. And when inflation happened, it may excite this axion field strongly or weakly, and in different parts of the universe, this axion field may have different value, okay? So you travel from your part of the universe with small axion field, and you go to another one with large axion field, and not much changes except for galaxy and the full history of the universe there will be different, and therefore, it is better for you to live in the part of the universe with this value of axion field rather than with some other value. But the transition from one part to another, in this example, is very smooth. But if you go from the place where there is electron and there is no electron in another place, you better not go there.
As a young physicist, how would you recommend deciding which questions are answerable? For example, your example of the proton to neutron mass, whether there's a theory, just be honest, that might explain why that's the case.
Well, I can only answer you by the statement which was made by some person who was meeting, the famous just a moment. Oh, whatever. Never mind who was this famous physicist. They were on the beach, and this famous physicist was swimming, and his biographer was swimming after him, Fermi, Enrico Fermi. Okay, so he was swimming after Fermi, and he asked, Enrico, and how is that you are so great in solving so many different problems, and do you have some methods? And Fermi just continue swimming, and he said after that, you know what, you must simplify the problem the best possible way to the maximum, and then you address it, and then at least you can solve it this way. And then he continues swimming. And then 10 seconds later, he stops and say, but you should not oversimplify, because if you oversimplify, you're solving a different problem. And then he continues swimming. And he say, oh, but how do you make a difference between simplifying and not oversimplifying? And he answers, and for that, you must be a genius like me. I don't know. No, seriously. Yeah. I am absolutely not a genius. When I was attending seminars of Liberty Physical Institute, I was feeling that I am an idiot. I just cannot go to physics because I understand only 10% of what is there. But I could not stop going there, okay? Because this was so interesting, I could not imagine doing anything else. And that may be the true answer.
Okay, back here.
You've told us a lot about the beginning of the universe. I was just wondering what your position is about the eventual fate of the universe.
The what?
The eventual fate of the universe, the end of the universe.
Oh, first of all, the universe is immortal, okay, as a whole, because during all of this process of producing new and new parts of the universe, the whole universe probably is not going to collapse. Now, I am not making a statement which I will later not be able to withdraw, because we're still learning how to study this. But to the best of what I can tell right now, the universe as a whole is immortal. Second, our own part of the universe, if we believe to what we believe now, and now we believe something which we didn't believe 20 years ago, 20, 30, 50 years ago, there were only two basic ways our universe can change, finish its existence. If it's open, it expands forever, and then there is a cold death. If it's closed, it eventually collapses, and then everybody dies in the hot. Okay, so you have two choices, but not much. Now we have several different possibilities. Our universe, our vacuum is most probably metastable if we trust what string theory tells us. So our vacuum will decay eventually, and then when it decays, it can go to the state where vacuum energy is negative, and then this part of the universe will collapse, and you will die in heat. But then there is another possibility that you will tunnel to the place where vacuum energy is exactly equal to zero, but the space is 10-dimensional. And then you die again, but for totally different reasons, because we cannot live in 10-dimensional space. And I am absolutely positive that in the future we will learn many more ways to die that we do not even suspect now.
If there is an infinite possible variation of universes, the multiverse, is it therefore possible that there is a possible multiverse in which there are no other multiverses to it? And does it therefore imply that there's a finite possible amount of universes? Or what does that imply?
Well, again, each time when we are trying to self-impose limitations on each other and on the multiverse, I am kind of doubtful. It is a good intellectual tradition to self-impose some rules on ourselves. And maybe there is some limitation indeed for the multiverse. But then open the book of Max Tegmark, who says that actually let's count multiverses, just any kind of consistent mathematical constructions, and I'm not sure whether I would go that far. On the other hand, just think about the moment of creation of our universe from the point of view of this, where these laws came from, okay? So let's just imagine that this myth of the universe creation makes sense, and there was a moment before which there was nothing, and then suddenly you have the universe. So then you may ask a question. Were the laws of the universe were written before the universe was born? Because either the universe was born, but the laws were not yet there, but then it could not expand, or if the universe was, I mean, what was first? If the law was first, then it must be written somewhere. The law, it's some information. What is information without the universe, okay? Maybe on the other, so here is the story. What was the first, whether it was space, whether it's a universe, whether it was information? Some wise men think that actually it is from bit, whatever. I don't know, and I do not know what are possible limits of variety of that. What is strange is that during the last 30 years, we were able to uncover this incredible richness of structures which are possible in physics, in cosmology, in string theory, which we are learning right now. Even what we uncovered is very preliminary, and whether it will be infinite or finite number of variations, I really don't know.
On that interesting note, in this universe, we are out of time. So let's thank Professor Andrei Linde one more time. Thank you.